Okay, welcome to ProComms Live at Lunch. Today we are tackling a topic that we haven't tackled yet this year. We're going to tackle onboarding. And so instead of bringing on my typical recruiters and salespeople that I have, what we're going to talk about, I've brought on our client services team who are actually specialists in onboarding. So you all know me from previous Live at Lunch, Wendy Canna. I'm the director of recruiting here at ProCom. So I will be the moderator of today's conversation, but I'm really going to turn it over to our experts in terms of onboarding. So I want to introduce our panel. So over here, I have Afshan. She's been with the organization for many years, dealing with multiple different clients. Carrie is our resident expert. She's been with ProCom for over 10 years and has worked on or touched pretty much every client that we've ever worked with. So she has an in-depth knowledge of everything. And then I have Shima over here, who's been with the company for a few years now, and again, touched on multiple different clients that we have. So this is our panel, and they're gonna be able to walk you through onboarding and what the do's and don'ts are and how you're gonna make that onboarding experience work for you efficiently and effectively. So one of the things we wanted to start off talking with, and what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna throw questions out to my panel here and let them walk through what's gonna get you onboarded as quickly and efficiently as possible. So getting started. So Carrie, why don't you take us through sort of that whole getting started, and let's talk about it when, from the time we get an offer. At that point is really when your team clicks into place and starts communicating with the individual who needs to be onboarded. So what sort of starts that whole process?
Well, first of all, we look at the details of the assignment, and we want to make sure that there's a telephone number and email address there. We'll reach out to you, the consultant, to confirm the details of the assignment. And then at that point, we'll follow up with either a welcome email or you'll receive an email from ProCom Express, which is our onboarding tool. Anyone concerned with privacy, this is a tool where you can upload all your documents and you know that there's gonna be no issues with privacy, everything's secure. So that's, we're very excited to have that here at ProCom. And then one of our onboarding specialists will be reaching out, and then Shima or Afshan are one of those. And then at that point, you'll start sending us your paperwork. So depending on your legal status, we always need either articles of incorporation, direct deposit details, including an EFT form and one of the void check with your company details imprinted on there. Direct deposit form and or bank statement. It's very important to have your company name in full on one of those documents. We require both documents just as a form of security. It's for your security as well as ProCom's to ensure that we're paying the proper person. And then the third item would be your HST registration. I'll pass it over to Afshan to maybe talk about sole proprietorships.
Okay, so for, again, if you're choosing the business status of being a sole proprietor, then we can use the direct deposit details on your name. So we will require a master service license. Again, any other details that are in your onboarding email, so the HST number. So just make sure when you do get the onboarding email from one of the client services specialists, make sure you read it properly so there's not much time wasted when you're returning the documents to us. So so the direct deposit details, just make sure that you're sending the correct direct deposit details. Almost all our consultants actually, we do require the background check, so fill out the consent forms correctly. If you are getting the HST number, make sure it is registered from the start date of the project. So if, for instance, if your start date is September 1st, make sure that it is registered from September 1st rather than September 15th. These are just some basic requirements that we have for sole proprietors as well.
Okay, and then again, if you're a temp employee and you're onboarding, there's gonna be a few different forms because obviously we're taxing you at source, so those are gonna be a few different forms that have to happen. But you talked about background checks. Mm-hmm. And that really has become a requirement for most clients. And I think when we talked about this in sort of preparation, we talked about the criminal background check was really the most prevalent amongst probably 90% of our clients, that everyone's doing a criminal background check. And then the other checks that are client dependent are the credit check, the the employment verification and the education verification. So why don't you talk, Shima, about sort of what are the things that possibly people should be disclosing to you before they do the background checks? And what are some of the things that could delay a background check? What are the normal time frames for them to get completed? And what are some of the delays that possibly could happen in that process?
Okay, so for all background checks, we ask for two pieces of ID. Number one that would get the ball rolling is make sure that the pictures are high resolution. So driver's license, passports. If you take a picture on your phone, once it gets scanned through to us, it's not necessarily very clear. So if we try to send that over to our background check company, they're not necessarily going to be able to read it or see it. So definitely make sure that you're scanning a proper high-resolution picture. Those would be.
So can they just take a picture of their phone and use that, or it has to be a scanned document?
If they take a picture on their phone, if you just send it by your phone, like if it's an iPhone or a BlackBerry, it doesn't always necessarily come through by the time we have to send it to the background. So as long as they can send it, as long as it's still showing up in a high resolution and that everything is legible, we can clearly see the picture, the validity dates on it. So definitely also make sure that your passport's not expired or your driver's license isn't expired, because then it won't be a valid ID to be able to use. And again, it could cause delays having to go back. In regards to the question about time frame, generally, again, across the board, most clients will be asking for a criminal background check. Those normally take between about 24 to 48 hours to get the results back. So it's a bit of a quicker process. Again, client specific, if they're looking for employment, education checks, then definitely those things will take a little bit longer. So in terms of not delaying it, making sure that you're going through the consent forms properly. So for example, if you have an employment check, do your due diligence. If you're not sure about the dates of it, go ahead and either, you know, call the previous HR or make sure that you have the dates correct, because there's always the chance if it comes back and the dates aren't matching on the check, again, it could cause delays. We'll have to go back and see why there's that discrepancy between whether it's like 2-3 months difference or longer. So definitely do the research, make sure that you've got the correct dates on there before you're sending through and writing those on the consent forms.
So we have a question. What, and I think we are covering it, what do you recommend the contractor do or have ready to expedite the onboarding process?
Yeah, so I think we've somewhat touched on that in terms of at the onboarding stage. Mm-hmm. So if you're, and again, it's going to, I think, differ, just to summarize what Carrie and Afshan said, was it depends on whether or not you're a temporary employee, an incorporated consultant, or a sole proprietor. It will depend on what those onboarding documents are. But at the basis, you're going to have proof of what your status of business is. So if it's a sole proprietorship, you need paperwork to state that. If it's a partnership, we're going to need paperwork for that. Or if it's if you have an incorporation, we're going to need your articles of incorporation. Then we're also going to need any tax information. So if you're a temp employee, we're going to need your provincial and federal forms. We're going to also need your social insurance number or social security number in the U.S. So again, you're going to need that type of information. And then obviously the next part of it is that we're going to need payment information, because obviously the whole goal of onboarding and taking a new assignment is that you need to be paid. So we're going to need if you're an incorporated entity, we're going to need a check with your incorporation name on that. And Carrie, why don't you touch on what we can and cannot accept in terms of proper payment information?
So typically, if you're newly incorporated, we recommend that you just go to the bank when you open that business account, because you will be required to open a business account to be paid if you're incorporated. Ensure that you ask for a direct deposit form. Have the teller stamp it and make sure that your company name matches exactly as it does on your articles of incorporation. If it's missing ink at the end, or Ontario ink, or whatever if it's missing a couple letters, unfortunately, we won't be able to accept that, and we'll have to ask you to go back and have that corrected. Some banks are issuing company imprinted starter checks now. Not all of them are, so if you do get a company imprinted starter check, that's fine, but typically they're going to give you a starter check that's blank, and if you write in your company name and address, etc., cetera, those details, we won't be able to accept that either. So again, company imprinted void check, direct deposit with a teller stamp, or a copy of the bank statement, which you can download from your online banking.
Yeah, and so, and the reason for that is really as a protection to you, that if we're paying, if you're stating yourself as an incorporated entity, and we need to be paying that incorporated entity, so if there is any audit trail, we've been paying your proper organization versus paying you into a personal account, because then there's no, we're not paying your business anymore, and those are things that can get caught up in an audit. So we want to make sure that we're paying you properly into the right account, and then obviously you're receiving that money. And the reason we want, a void check, or we want a direct deposit form with a stamp on it, is once the money transfers from our account, if you just provide us digits, handwritten without any stamp from the bank, or it's not on a check, unfortunately, once the money leaves our account and goes to this account, if it's not proper, there's a whole process in terms of us being able to retrieve those funds, and in terms of the time it would take for you to get that money. So we, once, if we have proper banking information, it ensures the payment to you is going to be efficient. There's not going to be any problems at that point.
And it also eliminates manual error. Just having everything on two pages, it ensures that our accounting department will get those details into the system correctly.
Absolutely. So we were kind of talking also about background checks. So again, this is going to be part of 90% of the onboardings that you do, whether that's with Procom or really any client, any company now. They're mandated not through the organization, not through Procom or any vendor that you're working with. They're really mandated at the client level as to what checks they want completed. So you're going to find out you may work on one assignment with us and only have to do a criminal background check. The next assignment, you may have to do the whole set of background checks. And that's really client dictated. And again, you may, depending on the client, even if you worked on one account, one client with us and had completed it, you may have to complete it again right from scratch with another client, depending on their rules.
The client will also require it from a specific back check third party provider. So if you have an Equifax credit report, that may not be sufficient for the client to use. They'll want to have it completed through their portal, through another portal. So also other clients might have you complete a credit check within a year's time if you're still on assignment. Each client has their own client specific requirements. So they don't actually come from Procom. It's not Procom asking you to complete a criminal credit check every couple of years, it's actually client required. So we're doing our best to ensure that these requirements are met and so that you can complete your assignment.
Yeah, so one of the things we talked about is how do things get delayed at the client side? And a lot of it has to do with the efficiency of having these documents available and filling out the forms in a timely manner. Because as Shima mentioned, the local checks take between 24 to 48 hours on your criminal and credit check, but it takes about a week for education, for North American
exactly.
Education. And it can take up to a week usually for employment verification as they're trying to reach out to other companies to verify that. And obviously those time frames extend once you get outside of North America, I'm assuming.
It could take sometimes up to, if it's an international either employment or education check, it could take up to even about 3 weeks. So we definitely recommend just providing as much information that you can and having accurate details. So for example, if the employment check is outside of Canada or the US, then make sure that you've got the dates correct on there. So again, just checking or making sure that the contact numbers you're providing on there has the correct contact number so that when they're trying to get in touch with them, they're actually able to get a hold of the appropriate person so that they can smoothly do the checks for them.
Absolutely.
We also want to let everybody know that we will be asking you to confirm your identity when you provide your IDs to us. And that's just a safeguard to make sure that you are the person you say you are. So one of the client services specialists will reach out to either do a Skype call or FaceTime, and you just to confirm that you are who you the person that we're speaking to matches the ID. It's just 30 seconds, and again, it's your protection, our protection. We're just trying to make sure that the people that we're onboarding to this client are who they say they are.
Absolutely. And so with the background checks and obviously getting the contract returned, having the background paperwork returned, obviously at that point we start to process that paperwork, and obviously there's time frames to when that comes back. Obviously the clients have onboarding processes that they have as well. And typically I think within most major companies, it probably takes anywhere from 3 to 7 days to procure security passes, hardware, a desk, to have somebody on site in most enterprise level clients. So if there's any delay in getting the clearance back, that can delay their start time frame. And so what can you suggest to people for that?
Again, I would say just make sure initially when you receive a phone call from us and you receive the onboarding email from us, just read everything properly, collect all the documents that you've been requested, and instead of going back and forth, just, you know, make sure you have everything that we require from you. If there's something that you're working on, let us know, and try to work on it as soon as possible. If you are getting incorporated, it's a new incorporation that you're setting up, just make sure that you work on it right away if this is the business that you're choosing. Other than that, Shima touched on a back check. So just make sure that all the consent forms are signed correctly, so, you know, it doesn't get unclear from the back check service provider that we're using. And what else would you suggest?
Always ensure that as long as we have all the consultant side requirements completed, then it's kind of on the client. So on the flip side, sometimes there's delays on the client side. There's levels of approvals that these requests have to go through. Sometimes there's 3 or 4 levels that they have to go through, and then once they're approved, a work order would be submitted through the system, and then we can provide you with the go ahead to and the start details to start. A lot of times we're just waiting on start details, and it's a matter of us following up and then following up with you, the consultant, to confirm that you can start. So sometimes it's kind of out of our hands, and we're doing our best to get the details. We're waiting from the client as well.
We have another question. How do I know if my contract will be extended?
It really depends on the client budget. So Procom, we generally follow up with a client a month in advance before your contract is being expired, before it's coming to an end. So we follow up with a client and ask if we can expect a contract extension for you. It also depends on your performance. So if your performance is great, we can expect a contract extension, again, based on the client's budget. In case your contract is not being extended, we will let you know in advance. And we do have a redeployment process here at Procom, so we will ask you to provide your most up-to-date resume, and we'll keep that on your file. You're more than welcome to apply any of the positions that you see on our Procom website. Follow up with your account manager if you feel comfortable, or your client service specialist team. And if you're interested in any of the positions, then let us know, and we'll see if we can, you know, get you any of the opportunities that are available.
Yeah, there's usually a job number, and then if you provide us with the job number, we can look it up in our system and then connect you with the recruiter working on that role.
Great.
Yeah.
So really we're looking to make sure that there's a smooth transition. And so the onboarding part is the first part of it, where we get all the paperwork, everything, and we have a start date now from the client. It's been communicated to you. The next critical step in that is really the first payroll, which is where we want to make sure that transition goes well. So what are some of the things that you guys could say that, you know, where things have fallen, like where, you know, maybe we haven't had proper banking information, or people haven't got approved timesheets, or they haven't logged into the system? Like, what are some of the things, those little trip ups that happen sometimes in those first few weeks, that hopefully if we communicate those, we can avoid them going forward?
Yeah, so we will send out direct deposit schedule to you, as well as access to any of the timesheet systems that you're using, such as FlexTrack. Just make sure that you submit a timesheet that's approved by the client. And we do need an approval from the client in order to pay you. So again, it's very important that you submit a client-approved timesheet on to Procom, whichever system you're using, if it's FlexTrack or any of the systems. We will touch back again on the direct deposit details. Make sure that the direct deposit you're submitting to us is by Procom's requirements, such as if it's a bank-stamped direct deposit form that we're asking for, do get that bank stamp on your direct deposit form so there's no delay. Even if your timesheet is approved and you're looking for the payment, but you haven't provided us the proper direct deposit details, which could cause delay in your payment.
Is there anything else that you guys can think of that would help? One of the things that we had talked about was, we're going to send you details to log into the timesheet system. It's probably best to try and log in before the day you have to submit your time to make sure that if your credentials aren't working properly or you're not able to access the site or you're not sure how to enter your time into the system and what you need to do, as much as we're going to send you documentation on how to do that, sometimes it's better to do it before Friday at 5 o'clock when your time's due. Try and get that done. Have a quick little run through, even if every day you're putting in your hours, even if you're not submitting it for approval, just to make sure that you know how to do it. Because every time everyone is a technical person that we're working with, but every system's a little bit different and there's things you may not be familiar with. And again, sometimes there's access issues that we can address before it's time to submit your time, because we don't want to delay your payment.
Right. Each client will be different depending on with each time reporting process. So make sure you read that time reporting email, because we have VMS systems such as Beeline and Fieldglass that process will be different from FlexTrack. So depending on the client, you'll be entering into a different system. So try to review that time reporting email. If you have questions about how to log in, as Wendy said, reach out to us. We're always available to help with that. But I do suggest to try to review the email, because everything will be in there along with the direct deposit schedule.
We can always walk you through. If you just give us a call, we can log in with you and walk you through. So it's definitely easier that way as well.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Go ahead.
Oh, another question. What if there's a delay on my timesheet being approved by my manager and I miss a payment?
But it is consultant's responsibility to follow with the manager. If you think your manager will be on vacation, let us know in advance. Get the timesheet either signed by them, or let us know if there's any other managers that are taking over their action items so we can set them up as a secondary timesheet approver. So let us know in advance if you know your manager will be away for a certain period of time. So again, it really is consultant's responsibility to follow up, but give us a call or send us an email and we'll see what best we can do for you.
Yeah, I mean, there's different scenarios for each. If it's going on, 2-3 weeks, we can, look at other options for you. So always try to let us know if that's happening beforehand so that we can figure out a solution.
Yeah, and so say for example, I submit my time, but I've just missed the deadline. Like, how long would my pay be delayed in general? Or is that very client specific in terms of how fast we can process it if it's, one day late that I got my time approved?
It is client specific, but we do as soon as those hours. Some hours come in on a feed, so they're uploaded at particular times during the week. Other hours that are entered into FlexTrack can be processed and approved the following week. So again, it will depend on the pay schedule. So if that does happen, just reach out to us, and again, we'll figure out a solution to get you paid within a week's time.
So we're trying to say is that we're going to try and be as accommodating as possible. But there is, I think
there are deadlines.
There is deadlines, and unfortunately, even if we transfer payment, it takes time for the bank to accept the payments and to process out those direct deposit feeds. So it's usually not a 12-hour turnaround that we can accommodate on those things.
It's probably a minimum of 2 business days.
Just to be, and again, I think the more you're aware of if there is going to be a delay on your side, and the more you can keep your client services team aware of that, the more we're able to come up with creative solutions that, have some sort of escalation where we're able to talk to the client to make sure that there is backups. So if your manager is going on a long 3-week vacation, that we make sure that they know that there's time going to be need to be approved in that duration. We're going to need to have a backup signature, and we can help facilitate that through our account management team and our client services team to make sure we're aware of those situations and we have those procedures in place.
Right.
Follow-up question. Do I have to submit a timesheet even if I have 0 hours to report or I'm on vacation?
Yes.
You definitely do. It's something that regardless of whether you've worked or not, you want to say 2 months down the line, you might not remember, but the way the schedules work, even if it's 0 hours, it still needs to be submitted. And sometimes in certain systems, unless, for example, in FlexTrack, if it's not approved for end of July, then sometimes the new timesheet won't come up so that you can enter hours for the new one. So definitely, even if it's 0 hours, if you're on vacation, we've had cases if you're on vacation and you forgot to do so, as soon as you come back, enter in those 0 hours and submit it still for approval, just so that you've got a clean record and it's just, you know, consistent.
We pull missing transactions,
yeah.
So if your previous week's hours aren't entered, we're going to reach out to you to please enter them. So whether they're zero or not, enter them, and then you won't have us kind of hounding you to enter your hours. And then, as Shima said in FlexTrack, if you don't enter the previous timesheet, you won't be able to submit the current timesheet.
Is there any other questions, Courtney, that come in?
That was the last one.
Okay, great. And so in terms of now that you, the other thing that we do as part of ProCom, as part of to check our quality of our services, is we send our surveys. So we're going to send a survey at the point of onboarding. So 5 days after you start, you should expect to see a survey coming from ProCom to talk about, you know, what we've done during our onboarding process and let us know if there's anything that we can fix there. We also want to touch in about 30 days later than that. You should see a second survey arriving. And that's really, again, to check in. And that's really covering off that first payroll process. Is there anything that's going on? Because we want to, again, make sure that that first month is a really successful and positive experience for you. And then really once we get through those periods, hopefully the ongoing assignment, there's not issues. But again, your client services team is here to help you through any of those problems that may come up, or just to sound things off of while you're on assignment. But really the next critical point is this 30 to 45 days before you're ending your assignment, which is kind of whether or not you're extending or offboarding. And so what are some of the things that you guys could recommend to people? Like, should they be reaching out to you? Should they be talking to their client? How does that information kind of come back to you guys to be processing extension paperwork or not?
I hate to sound like a broken record, but it's very client specific.
Mm-hmm.
Again, some clients don't allow ProCom to have direct contact with them if there's an MSP involved, a managed services provider. So at that point, we would have to reach out to the MSP and they would reach out to the client. So in that case, it's good for you to have a conversation with your manager. If you know you're going to be extended, then we can ask the MSP to reach out to the client to get that started in the VMS system. And then if other clients, the account manager will reach out to the client to confirm the extension, and then we'll reach out to you. So it'll kind of depend on what the client requires in that case.
So I think really what it is if you may know before we know in
mm-hmm.
some cases, and in which case if you know that there's an extension pending and you're really waiting on the paper to get that, to solidify that, let us know, because often we're not hearing about it till maybe after you already know. And it's not from lack of us wanting to send you updated paperwork, it's the fact that we haven't got anything through official channels. But if you let us know that your manager has said they want to extend, what we can do is sort of make sure that that process is flowing through, and we've put the calls in, and we can make sure that we're going to get something back from the client. We'll keep you up to date as to what time frame we think we can get that paperwork from them. So I think communication's key.
Yes. Yeah, and again, I mean, if there's a chain of approvals involved, especially with VMS, so an extension could be pending approval in the system, and it's going through different levels of approval. So that's kind of where the waiting game happens.
And we can see that in the system.
Yeah.
So, you know, if you have questions and you're not sure, you know, that your client services person can let you know whether or not we see something pending there. It doesn't necessarily mean it could get stopped somewhere through the approval process. Mm-hmm. We can let you know where it is within that process that we're seeing. Now, is there anything other successful tips that you guys, or anything that you think we should be touching on within the onboarding process?
Yeah, I would say on your first day, just make sure you arrive early. Make sure you know where you're going. Google the address. Just find out where the location is if you haven't been there before. If the interview was over the phone or Skype, just make sure that you're going to the right location. Arrive early. Bring some IDs with you just because sometimes they do have a security process, so they like to see. You make sure that you have your IDs with you. They like to see the IDs. And yeah, just have fun on your first day.
I'd like to say for returning consultants, if you are a returning consultant, we'll do our best to check the system for any previous paperwork we've had. If it's been a few years, we may need a couple items again, so just bear with us because our internal requirements have changed and there may be an EFT form that wasn't provided before that we may need you to fill out now. Banking details, again, if they have changed, we'll confirm that with you, but try to let us know as well so there's no
we don't want to be paying
rejection
the wrong, yeah.
from the bank. Yeah.
And any last minute things that you can think of that you felt like we haven't touched on yet?
I think we pretty much touched on everything, but just further to what Ashen was saying, either for your first day, again, punctuality is definitely key. Being early is better than, you know, rushing, trying to get there. It just shows a little bit more effort on your side to the client as well. And again, like she said, kind of have fun your first day. We will normally like touch base with you during maybe that first week as well. Reach out to us if you feel like, you know, something wasn't as you expected. Just, you know, keep that open communication, I'd say.
Great. And is there any other questions, Courtney?
Not today.
Great. Well, thank you very much for joining us here on our Facebook Live at Lunch, and we'll see you next month.
Bye. Bye.